people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a weekly Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we exhort, we edify, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about the well water of Bethlehem. The well water of Bethlehem. And our case study is going to be David. And we want to look into the life of that wonderful king of Israel. He has a lot to teach us, right? But before we start unpacking, let's pray. Father, we thank you. Because you are the real king. You are the King of Kings. And Lord, we want to say thank you, for we recognize your lordship and your kingship over this world. The Bible says the earth is full of your possessions, even over those who think they run their lives. You still have the final say. And so, Lord, we have come to you. Have your way in this Bible teaching, Lord. And let Jesus alone be glorified. Holy Spirit, take this program away from me and do it your own way to bless your people, to save souls. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. The well water of Bethlehem. And like I said, case study is David. And the story can be found in the first Chronicles chapter 11, verse 17 to 19. We are not going to read that on this program, but I challenge you to go read it. It's very beautiful, very short, but powerful story. The foundation text is Isaiah chapter 55, verse 1. The book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verse 1. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Yes, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Now, in this very short story, David was in the stronghold, and history places that very close to the cave of Adullam. And of course, he was in battle with the Philistines, as always. And at the time, the Philistines had made such a huge incursion into the land of Israel. So much so, they had their garrisons in Bethlehem. So they were fighting, and David and his group, they were in the stronghold, and David, having fought for a while, became tired and thirsty. And he said, oh, how I wish I could get some of the water from the well of Bethlehem. And three of his soldiers, they fought through the enemy's line to go get him some water. So that's where we picked our topic from. So why did David need the well water of Bethlehem? Number one, longing. David was thirsty for the water of Bethlehem, which he grew up drinking. I don't know if that happens to you, but I experience it once in a while. Nostalgia of maybe some things I did growing up, some food, some, you know, some way of life that you grew up on. And you are like, oh man, I wish I could go back in time, you see. So that was what was happening here to David. He grew up on the well water of Bethlehem. Now, for us, this has not changed too, you see. Almost everyone, listen carefully, almost everyone longs for their life to turn out in a particular way. Because God made you for a specific purpose. He made me for a specific purpose. So our lives naturally begins to long for that purpose. David was in the stronghold while he fought the Philistines who had stationed their army in Bethlehem. We too, we're on the battlefield of life. Have you noticed that? Huh? We're on the battlefield. Humanity is fighting against disease, death, divorce, and other devastating circumstances of life, you see. Our heart yearns to stop the pain because God didn't create life starting out with that. So we want to stop the pain and quench the thirst too. We want to live a fulfilling, peaceful, and prosperous life, you see. Because that's the way God made us starting out. Not with pains, not with debt, not with death, you see. Let's go to the book of Psalm 55, verse 6. Psalm 55, verse 6. So I said, this is the psalmist speaking now. Oh, that I had wings like a dove. I would fly away and be at rest. I don't know about you, but listen, I believe very much in confession. I'm not talking about going to the priest. That's not what I'm saying, but exposing what the enemy can have on you as secrets. Listen, let me confess to you. So many times I have felt like what David is saying right here. I totally understand what David is saying by the Spirit here, that I just want to go somewhere quiet, and you know, because you feel like the whole thing is closing on you, you see. Let's go to the book of 1 Kings, chapter 19, verse 4c. We stop at 4d. And we are talking about longing. And he prayed that he might die. That's Elijah. And said, it is enough. Now, Lord, take my life, for I am no better than my father's. That doesn't sound like somebody singing Christmas carol, does it? Huh? That sounded like somebody who has had it and was looking for the next exit, and he said, Lord, do me a favor, just do your thing, kill me and let me go. You see, because he was longing for peace. He was tired of the battle. So we all long like David. A sickly soul cannot produce a blossoming body. Forget it. Let's come back again and say that. A sickly soul cannot produce a blossoming body. So if you are fixing your life with things around you, it's not gonna work. When the soul is sick, the body can't do so much, all right? Moving on. Fighting. So David needed the well water of Bethlehem because he was longing for it, because he was fighting. The well water of Bethlehem was not accessible for David because the garrison of the Philistines, the enemy, are taking over Bethlehem, his own town. The system of this world, listen up carefully, is under the sway of the devil. Why? Because Adam sold it through disobedience against the command of God. When Adam disobeyed, he gave the devil the legal right that the devil needed or wanted. So the devil became the ruler of this world ever since, to access and obtain God's purpose for each life has become an invisible spiritual battle which rages on in the human mind and heart between mankind who wants God's purpose and Satan who doesn't want you to find God's purpose for your life, you see. The devil is still reigning today in the lives of those who do not have Jesus. But for those who have Jesus in their heart, the devil has no power in their lives, you see. I know of, when I was thinking about this message, really, three ladies came up to my mind. Two of them, I know one personally, and a friend knew the other lady personally. I mean, these ladies, they packed up from their matrimonial homes and traveled to join the boyfriends they met on social media. They left their families. Why? Because they were looking for something that they believed the problem was their husbands or the too many children around or whatever their problem was. They were fighting for something. And they thought, if I change husbands, maybe that will work. No. I know of an individual too who changes job like every 6 months. I mean, good, beautiful job. There was a particular job he got that they were going to send him to college and they were promoting this person. And before we knew it, he resigned. I'm like, oh my goodness. You see, that individual is fighting, but he thought it's a physical fight, but it's a spiritual fight, you see. Oh, maybe the problem is this job, so let me move to another job. No, it's not. It's a spiritual, invisible battle. Isaiah 55 verse 2 says, Isaiah chapter 55 verse 2, we start 2a, we stop at 2b. Why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy? Why? Huh? Why? Your mother-in-law is not your problem. Oh no. Your boss is not your problem. No. Whatever fight you are in right now, the source, the root of your problem is not physical, it's spiritual. You cannot use something physical to fix a spiritual battle. It's not gonna work. You don't use aspirin for cancer. No. You use medical treatment that can destroy cancer to kill cancer. You see, it's the same way. So stop spending your money for what is not bread. Of course, the Bible is speaking metaphorically there, okay? So as we go on, you will see how you can fight this battle with the right weapon. Sin uses inner self to destroy outer self. Joseph in Zion. Somebody didn't hear that, so repeat that again. Sin uses inner self to destroy outer self. So stop engaging in what is not, sex, money, drugs, and all that is not. The devil will be using that to destroy you from the inside, and it will be showing on the outside. Moving on. Bring it. So David needed the well water of Bethlehem because he was longing for it, because he was fighting, and now they were bringing the water to him. David's soldiers brought the water, three of them, from Bethlehem for David to drink. However, unlike David's soldiers who had to fight through the enemy's camp, we don't have to. Hallelujah. The Holy Trinity fought and won the battle for you and for me. God the Father gave his Son, his only begotten Son. God the Son, Jesus, willingly laid down his life, and God the Holy Spirit resurrected him on the third day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The power of sin, death, and hell, listen up close, were destroyed forever while their physical activities may look potent. In the spiritual sense, it's been destroyed forever. Their evil enterprise cannot, underscore that, cannot hurt a follower of Christ Jesus. You see, I was thinking about a friend who passed a few months back, a friend of the family, and while you look at the circumstances, the family dynamics and all that, that this individual left behind, is so painful. I'm telling you, very painful. But you know what? In the real sense, in the real spiritual sense, praise God. Because this individual is now home with Jesus. You see, death appeared to be potent and strong, physically speaking, but Jesus has destroyed that power because this individual is now home with Jesus. You see, the life, and the life more abundantly, promised by Jesus to those who receive him, is to bring us back into fellowship with God. That is the life, and the life abundantly. Not a lot of money in the bank, as some apostates would like you to believe. One said 3,000 square feet of swimming pool. Where did you find that in the Bible? Huh? The life, and the life more abundantly, is the fellowship with God, so we can live a purposeful life according to God's plan for us. This is the well water of Bethlehem that every heart is searching for today. I remember when I got saved, I came out of my house, number 19 Dunlop Street. I won't say the rest, to save the people living there now. In Sydney, Australia, you see. And I looked at the tree. There's a big old tree in the garden in front of my house. I mean, the leaves were so green. The plants, the flowers, everything looked so different. And I asked myself, have I been living in this house before now? I mean, everything looked so different. My spirit came alive because now I have fellowship with God. I mean, I started living from the inside, you see. Isaiah 55:2c. Listen carefully to me. This is God speaking to you. So listen up. And eat what is good. God is saying, listen to me. Obey me. Listen to what I'm trying to tell you and receive what is good. And let your soul delight itself in abundance. Listen, God is a good God. He has nothing evil to give you. Oh no. Because the Bible says there is no wickedness found in God, nor any iniquity in the Almighty. Oh no, you can't. God is not going to give you anything evil. So it's for your own good to listen to him and receive him. If you key into that fellowship, you are made. That is success. That's it. John 15:5. This is the Lord himself speaking. John 15:5. The Yahweh of the Old Testament is the Jesus of the New Testament. So let's see what he has to say. I am the vine. This is Jesus speaking now. You are the branches. Have you ever seen a branch cut off from a tree, living by itself? I don't think so. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Without me, Jesus is saying, you can do nothing. You see, Jesus is saying, listen, I'm the old enchilada. You don't stick with me, you kaput. You won't be able to do anything physically, spiritually, maritally, forget it. You see, he brought you life that he might bring forth your life. Come on now, Josephine, keep quiet. Let's say that again, because the Lord is speaking to these people. They need to hear it again. He brought you life that he might bring forth your life. Jesus brought you his life so he can bring your life out. Until you key into the life of Jesus, you're not going to be able to bring forth what you are supposed to bring forth in life. Now, we have talked about the reasons why David, like us, need the well water of Bethlehem. So what did David do with the well water of Bethlehem? Offering. That's all David did. David refused to drink the water that was brought to him from the well of Bethlehem, because the water's value became as precious as the blood of the three soldiers who brought it. So he offered the water unto God. Our lives are to be offered unto God in appreciation of what he did for us to buy back our dead life from the slave market of sin and the path to perdition. When you surrender your heart to Jesus and he becomes the pilot of your life, you are acting like David in showing appreciation. You are offering that life. Anything short of that is a deliberate affront and an outright rebellion against God. It's an affront to God. No one, listen up close, no one will go to hell for any reason other than their sin of rejection of Jesus. Some people, they like to corner Christians. Are homosexuals going to hell? Listen, no, it's not only homosexuality. Liars, murderers, gossip, whatever, it's all in the Bible. The Bible doesn't discriminate. Everything that we take a man or a woman to hell is robed up in this sin, rebellion. When you say it's my will, not your will, God, that's it. And how do you say that? By rejecting Jesus. So the only thing that will take any person to hell is the rejection of Jesus. And you just don't say that, it's how you live your life. If you live your life against the injunction of the Bible, you are telling God, you be your own boss, let me be my own boss, you see. This is the sin against the Holy Spirit, to reject Jesus. It's the unpardonable sin. It's unforgivable. Any life that is not domesticated by Jesus has rejected Jesus. And I thank God for giving me that word, domesticated. Because if you have a family pet, you will know what domestication means. It means your natural self doesn't want to do that, because the natural life cannot, it's difficult for natural life to obey the spirit. But if you let Jesus domesticate your life, then you are in on your way to heaven. Matthew 7:21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. That's Jesus himself speaking. So it doesn't matter if you're a pastor, pope, preacher, it doesn't matter. If you are just talking the talk, but Jesus is not doing the walk in your life, he said you are not going anywhere. To reject Jesus in your life is to shipwreck yourself in life. Let's say that again. To reject Jesus in your life is to shipwreck yourself in life. So, what have we done so far? Why did David need the well water of Bethlehem? Longing. Our life has been designed by God with a void to be filled with a specific purpose. However, the purpose is unknown until the void is filled. Finally, filling the void in the heart became a battle due to the spiritual disorder caused by man's disobedient nature against God. Bringing, Jesus corrected the spiritual disorder, hallelujah, and made it possible to fill the void. If we receive Jesus into that hole in our heart, he will fill it and we will find our purpose. What did David do with the well water of Bethlehem? Offering. We are to let Jesus control the affairs of our lives in every area of life. So let's conclude. Are you a believer with a troubled life that needs physical things to prop yourself or make you happy? Huh? Is that your own kind of Christianity? This is biblically impossible. No. Why? Because Jesus said, your heart will rejoice and no one will take your joy from you. No one, no circumstance will take your joy from you. Jesus said that in John 16:22. We are not reading that, but check it out. So if your life as a child of God, as you claim, needs some superficial physical things to be happy, to prop yourself, that is biblically impossible. No. Even when you're going through stuff, a joy that comes from the Holy Spirit is not disturbed. No. Check if Jesus is truly the only pilot of your life. If you're a co-pilot, it's not going to work out. The flesh and the spirit do not agree. Are you an unbeliever? Huh? What is your idea of a satisfied, fulfilling life? Huh? Money? Huh? Fame? Sex? Drugs? Is that your own definition of a fulfilling life? Let me help you out. I love Dr. Rogers and the way he defined it. These are synthetic salvation, which gives instant heaven that leads to eternal hell. End of quote. In Josephine Zion's translation, you are living a frustrated life. Got it? Frustrated life. Life is a desert for anyone without Jesus. And you know, I used to teach world geography and history as a high school teacher. I can tell you a little bit about desert. It's super hot in the afternoon and in the night it's below zero. Freezing level. See, so that's why if your life is a yo-yo, now you know why. You are happy when something is going on and the next minute you are looking for a way to do something to yourself because nothing is working again. It's because your life is a desert. Jesus said, I am your peace. If you receive him into your life, you have a choice to make. You are not free not to make a choice. No, you are not. God has put a hole in your heart that only Jesus can fill up. To receive Jesus into that hole in your heart is to find true satisfaction in life. If you want the inner peace that cannot be threatened by the drought of life circumstances, listen up. Jesus is the only choice you have, not Washington. Washington needs help. Hollywood needs help. Hollywood really is a train wreck. So Jesus is the only option that you have. If you are ready to take this offer, which is not going to last, a link is coming up. Click on that link and we will meet you on the website it takes you. It's called Want to Know Jesus. All right? Because you need that inner peace. But you need Jesus. You need to receive him to get that inner peace. Let us pray. Father, thank you. Holy Spirit, thank you for using me and speaking through me to your people. As many lives, oh Lord, that are longing for this inner peace, and they want to make peace with you, Holy Spirit, let them comprehend the words that have been spoken from this teaching program, more than I could explain to them. Holy Spirit, teach them yourself. Give them the divine comprehension. And for us who have already received the peace of God, help us, O Lord, to continue to share your peace with others so as to bring them out of life's desert into your peace. Thank you, Father. For in Jesus' name I will pray. Amen and amen. I will see you next week. Only if Jesus has not split the sky open.